Hachette Audio presents Battlemage. Written by Stephen Aryan. Read by Matt Addis.
Chapter 1. Another light snow shower fell from the bleak grey sky. Winter should have been over, yet ice crunched underfoot and the mud was hard as stone. Frost clung to almost everything, and a thick, choking fog lay low on the ground. Only those desperate or greedy travelled in such conditions. 2 nights of sleeping outdoors had leached all the warmth from Vargus's bones. The tips of his fingers were numb and he couldn't feel his toes anymore. He hoped they were still attached when he took off his boots. He'd seen it happen to others in the cold. Whole toes had come off and turned black without them noticing, rolling around like marbles in the bottom of their boots. Vargus led his horse by the reins. It would be suicide for them both to ride in this fog. Up ahead, something orange flickered amid the grey and white. The promise of a fire gave Vargus a boost of energy and he stamped his feet harder than necessary. Although the fog muffled the sound, it would carry to the sentry up ahead on his left. The bowman must have been sitting in the same position for hours as the grey blanket over his head was almost completely white. As Vargus drew closer, his horse snorted, picking up the scent of other animals, men, and cooking meat. Vargus pretended he hadn't seen the man and tried very hard not to stare at his longbow. After stringing the bow with one quick flex, the sentry readied an arrow, but in order to loose it, he would have to stand up.
"That's far enough."
That came from another sentry on Vargas's right, who stepped out from between the skeletons of 2 shattered trees. He was a burly man, dressed in dirty furs and mismatched leathers. Although chipped and worn, the long sword he carried looked sharp.
"You a king's man?"
Vargas snorted.
"No, not me."
"What do you want?"
He shrugged.
"A spot by your fire's all I'm after."
Despite the fog, the sound of their voices must have carried as 2 others came towards them from the camp. The newcomers were much like the others, desperate men with scarred faces and mean eyes.
"You got any coin?"
asked one of the newcomers, a bald and bearded man in old-fashioned leather armour. Vargus shook his head.
"Not much, but I got this."
Moving slowly, he pulled 2 wineskins down from his saddle.
"Shale rice wine."
The first sentry approached. Vargus could still feel the other pointing an arrow at his back. With almost military precision, the man went through his saddlebags, but his eyes nervously flicked towards Vargus from time to time. A deserter, then, afraid someone had been sent after him.
"What we got, Lynn?"
called Baldy.
"A bit of food. Some silver, not much else,"
the sentry answered.
"Let him pass."
Lynn didn't step back.
"You sure, boss?"
The others were still on edge. They were right to be nervous if they were who Vargas suspected. The boss came forward and keenly looked Vargas up and down. He knew what the boss was seeing. A man past 50 summers, battle-scarred and grizzled with liver spots on the back of his big hands. A man with plenty of grey mixed in with the black stubble on his face and head.
"You gonna give us any trouble with that?"
asked Baldy, pointing at the bastard sword jutting up from Vargas's right shoulder.
"I don't want no trouble. Just a spot by the fire and I'll share the wine."
"Good enough for me. I'm Cor. These are my boys."
"Vargus."
He gestured for Vargus to follow him and the others eased hands away from weapons.
"Cold enough for you?"
"Reminds me of a winter. Must be 20 years ago up north. Can't remember where."
"Travelled much?"
Vargas grunted.
"All over. Too much."
"So where's home?"
asked Cor. The questions were being asked casually, but Vargas had no doubt about it being an interrogation.
Right now, here.
They passed through a line of trees where 7 horses were tethered. Vargus tied his horse up with the others and walked into camp. It was a good sheltered spot, surrounded by trees on 3 sides and a hill with a wide cave mouth on the other. A large roaring fire crackled in the middle of camp, and 2 men were busy cooking beside it. One was cutting up a hare and dropping pieces into a bubbling pot, while the other prodded some blackened potatoes next to the blaze. All of the men were armed, and they carried an assortment of weapons that looked well used. As Vargas approached the fire, a massive figure stood up and came around from the other side. It was over 6.5 feet tall, dressed in a bearskin and wide as 2 normal men. The man's face was severely deformed, with a protruding forehead, small brown eyes that were almost black, and a jutting bottom jaw with jagged teeth.
"Easy, Rack," said Kor.
The giant relaxed the grip on his sword, and Vargas let out a sigh of relief.
"He brought us something to drink."
Rack's mouth widened, revealing a whole row of crooked yellow teeth. It took Vargas a few seconds to realize the big man was smiling. Rack moved back to the far side of the fire and sat down again. Only then did Vargas move his hand away from the dagger on his belt. He settled close to the fire next to Kor, and for a time no one spoke, which suited him fine. He closed his eyes and soaked up some of the warmth, wiggling his toes inside his boots. The heat began to take the chill from his hands, and his fingers started to tingle.
"Bit dangerous to be travelling alone,"
said Kor, trying to sound friendly.
"I suppose so, but I can take care of myself."
"Where are you headed?"
Vargas took a moment before answering.
"Somewhere I'll get paid and fed. Times are hard, and I've only got what I'm carrying."
Since he'd mentioned his belongings, he opened the first skin and took a short pull. The rice wine burned the back of his throat, leaving a pleasant aftertaste. After a few seconds, the warmth in his stomach began to spread. Kor took the offered wineskin, but passed it to the next man, who snatched it from his hand.
"Rack, it's your turn on lookout,"
said Lin. The giant ignored him and watched as the wine moved around the fire. When it reached him, he took a long gulp and then another before walking into the trees. The archer came back, and another took his place as sentry. 2 men standing watch for a group of 7 in such extreme weather was unusual. They weren't just being careful. They were scared.
"You ever been in the King's army?"
asked Lin. Vargas met his gaze, then looked elsewhere.
"Maybe."
"I reckon that's why you travelled all over, dragged from place to place. One bloody battlefield after another. Home was just a tent and a fire. Different sky, different enemy."
"Sounds like you know the life. Are you a king's man?"
"Not any more,"
Lin said, with a hint of bitterness. It didn't take them long to drain the first wineskin, so Vargas opened the second and passed it around the fire. Everyone took a drink again except Kor.
"Bad gut,"
he said when Vargas raised an eyebrow.
"Even a drop would give it a shits."
"More for us,"
said one man with a gap-toothed grin. When the stew was ready, one of the men broke up the potatoes and added them to the pot. The first 2 portions went to the sentries, and Vargas was served last. His bowl was smaller than the others, but he didn't complain. He saw a few chunks of potato and even 1 bit of meat. Apart from a couple of wild onions and garlic, the stew was pretty bland, but it was hot and filling. The food, combined with the wine and the fire, helped warm him all the way through. An itchy tingling started to creep back into his toes. It felt as if they were all still attached. When they'd all finished mopping up the stew with some flatbread and the second wineskin was empty, a comfortable silence settled on the camp. It seemed a shame to spoil it.
"So, why are you out here?" asked Vargas.
"Just travelling, looking for work like you,"
said Kor.
"You heard any news from the villages round here?"
One of the men shifted as if getting comfortable, but Vargus saw his hand move to the hilt of his axe. Their fear was palpable. Kor shook his head.
Not been in any villages. We keep to ourselves.
The lie would have been obvious to a blind and deaf man.
I heard about a group of bandits causing trouble in some of the villages round here. First it was just a bit of thieving and starting a couple of fights. Then it got worse when they saw a bit of gold.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.